Our second speaker now, Gabriele Pollini from Mentor, a Siemens business, where he is product marketing manager. The title of the talk is An Emulation Strategy for Artificial Intelligence Designs. Gabriele Pollini joined Mentor in 1991 and is part of the emulation business unit within Mentor, a Siemens business. He's responsible for a new business opportunity with a particular focus on self-driving and artificial intelligence applications. He's located in France. So over to you, Gabriele.
Thank you, Mike. Good morning, good afternoon to everybody. Yeah, it's a pleasure to be here, even if it is remote. I'm based in France in the Paris office, which is usually a very animated place, and is strange to be here confined in a room talking to more than 100 people through through a computer. In France, is a very animated place. The office is the is one of the R&D centers for the emulation product line from Mentor Graphics. Is where we design the earth of the emulation system, like Tesla or Apple. We do a vertical integration. We design everything from the reconfigurable chip that is used for the hardware emulation system to the boards, to the multi-board systems, and to the systems and the software goes with it to making this machine very usable. And one of the targets of the hardware emulation system today, one of the market that we are targeting is the one for artificial intelligence applications. And we will see what are the implications of verifying such type of a complex SoC, and as well what are the key elements and the key features that the hardware emulation should comply to be able to deliver, you know, quality results and to be efficient during your verification process. And we know that artificial intelligence is everywhere. It fools all the different businesses that are around us and are actually, you know, dictating a new type of lives and as well offering major advances in different areas. One which is quite amazing is all around healthcare, as we know. It would be possible, for example, to diagnose cancers 3-4 years in advance compared to current procedures. And the other one, which is quite interesting, is that the you know, this network of data that will be you know, driving our life in the cities and the public spaces. With everybody will be connected to anything and will be an exchange of data among the different actors of the life in the city. And the other one, which is quite interesting and promising, is around the automation of the cars. So to have fully autonomous cars, to have self-driving cars on the cities. So we see that and we are almost, we can say we are going into the fourth industrial era, probably. So we have new energies that are coming in to replace the fossil ones. We have a new communication means that will allow to exchange a huge amount of data among the different elements of our environment. And as well, we have a new ways of transportations that that are raising up and fueled with new alternative energies, electric and so forth. So we see that artificial intelligence is something which is in the earth of our current and will be even more in the future. And designing these chips actually is quite it's quite a challenge because it's something that is coming up totally new and it requires as well an exhaustive verification. I mean, and we'll see those applications acting on the critical aspect of our life and we need to make sure that everything complies to the different requirements and to the different specifications, as sometimes are safety critical specifications. And the exhaust verification of those chips are quite challenging as well, because the capacity of those devices, we have seen some examples on the previous presentation from Xilinx, from Tesla, many others. And yeah, we have designs that can go up to the 4 or 5 billion gates today, and they're even growing. And a lot of exchange of data, as we have seen, adders and multipliers are the key elements of those algorithms, and that require as well a lot of exchanges with memories. So the memory architectures and the exchanges of data is key for having an efficient solution with contained power consumptions. And all these needs to be as well debugged when we do the verification in a very productive way. And this goes not only with the hardware, obviously, but you have, the new software frameworks that are used for those applications. You know, the CAFE, the TensorFlow, etc. And as well with the new custom software stack that are implemented to add the proper secret sauce to differentiate the solutions compared to the other players in the market. And it's becoming a very competitive market. And we are seeing a raising, as we have seen until now on the smartphone market. There are, publicly released benchmarks that allows to compare different solutions in the market. And one of the key metrics is the performance per consumption, so per power consumption, is what they call the teleoperations per watt, the TOPS per watt. And these are the metrics that dictate the success or not. Oh, something went, sorry. That are dictating the success or not of a particular player in the market. So it's very important to be able to anticipate the needs and the performance of the own device well before having the silicon. And so the challenges, to summarize, is a very large transistor count. And when we are verifying those, not only designing, but we are verifying as well the new architectures. So we are talking about the tensor processing unit, the neural network processors and neural processing engines. So there are the type of new architectures are coming in the market with a new customized software stacks, and as well the different ways to put the silicon together. We see different approaches, 2D, 3D chiplets, and as well we have seen a full wafer scale integrated circuit like a Cerebras that is coming with a huge wafer, which represents one holistic chip for machine learning, artificial intelligence applications. And the FPGA fabric, as we have seen from Xilinx, is another way to approach solutions for custom artificial intelligence logic. And as well, we see that coming into the computational storage driver market, as well as the hyperscale data centers applications. So these large capacity, new architectures, and as well the different ways to put the silicon together creates some key challenges for those that are designing and verifying those devices. And what is needed from an hardware emulation system to be effective on the process of verifying those devices? There are three pillars that dictates, the quality of the results of the hardware emulation usage during this process. One is the determinism, the scalability, and as well the virtualization. We're trying to understand why these are key elements on the different aspects of the verification of those complex devices. Determinism, I mean, the key, I'm verifying a complex complex algorithm together with very complex hardware, and it's important to be sure that the results that I'm analyzing and the way I am analyzing the results have a completely deterministic approach. So to be able to repeat the experiment, to be able to nail down a potential problem and to repeat the experiments in exactly the same manner, to be able to optimize certain architectures, certain algorithms, certain software, and the things that wouldn't be possible with the real hardware, pre-production prototypes or in the lab, because the different experiments will heavily depend on the status of the hardware that is around my system for, you know, the determining the behavior of a particular function. So the initial states, the undeterministic behavior of the environment of my system may make it very difficult to optimize my architecture without having the possibility of virtualizing the whole environment with a very deterministic environment. And this for the emulation system goes at different levels. First, I mean a deterministic model building. I need to be sure that the hardware emulation system provides an environment of both hardware and software that ensures that the compilation process of my design into the hardware engine that will be used for accelerating the verification process offers a deterministic representation of my model into the system. And so to be able to reproduce exactly the same results from one run to another. So have as well a deterministic execution of the different tests that will be performed for my device. Test that is not only a functional test, but as well that goes behind just the pure functionalities of my algorithm. But I want to check as well if it is architecture complies and is with the regulations, but as well if it is competitive compared to the other players in the market. And if I identify problems, if I spot the problems during my verification process, problems could be due on poor performance, functional bugs, both hardware and software, and as well problems related to an overpower consumption that I spotted during the verification. I want to be able to reproduce exactly the same experiments to be able to debug and to correct the possible misfunctions of my environment. And so this is a key for being able to have a reproducible problem and to be able to improve and to analyze in a consistent way through the whole process the different aspects of my architecture. And the scalability for an emulator as well is very important. I mean, different types of devices on the AI application space. And with the different types of capacity requirements, complexity that are growing over time. So I have my emulation system that needs first to be able to fit the capacity that I need today, but as well it needs to be very scalable for satisfying the future once my complexity will grow to adapt to new raising needs. So this is the scalability is very important to address is a wide variety of designs that we see that spans from the artificial intelligence edge devices, for example, the ones that goes into the smart cameras, on the facial recognitions that we see everywhere now in smartphones and vision monitors and so forth. So from the edge devices up to the complexity of devices that are on the cloud and the data centers, but we have now a large silicon footprint with, you know, that is required for offering the compute power needed for this type of applications from machine learning, big data manipulations, storage, and so forth. And we have as well a different ratio of power consumption between the edge devices and the data center type of devices. On one side, we have a very high memory bandwidth and with very power hungry devices on the data center versus low latency and low power for the edge devices. And in the case of the Veloce solutions, and you can see on this picture, we have a scalable set of hardware platforms. You can see here on the bottom of the picture, where you have a system that can grow as a Lego, depending on the needs of the designs. Here you can start from 40 million gates with a single board into a chassis, and you can grow up connecting multiple boards, multiple emulation boards, within multiple emulation chassis, up to multi-systems. You can go up to the 10, 15 billion gates capacity to accommodate, you know, your capacity needs. But regardless the capacity and the system configuration that you are used, the most likely will be sitting on the data center. The usage of this engine comes from you know, the OS that has been designed for this system, and the Veloce StratOS that allows to interface between the user and the machine different verification levels and different verification processes that are achieved through different solutions and applications that are built on top of this Veloce StratOS software. So solutions, they could be solutions that allows to create the test bench specific to a particular application. Could be networking applications, could be storage applications, could be automotive applications. So you can build both physical, what we call ICE solutions, but as well the virtual solutions to create the operating environment of your device on the real life. And these are through different, as well, you have a different memory models and so forth. But as well, as I said, it's not only a matter of validating the functionality of the chip, but as well through a set of applications that have been developed on top of this engine, you'll be able to validate, for example, the power consumption, estimate what are the activity peaks of your device on the real operating conditions, because we have created the actual environment where the chip will be used using the different solutions that are available for the different market applications. So you'll be able to do the power, for example, power estimation. You can do coverage. You can do a software debug. And we were talking previously, as well as been mentioned, for example, certifications against ISO 26262 for, you know, autonomous driving. You can inject faults and to see how the different safety mechanism of your chip that is dedicated to self-driving application reacts. You can visualize, you know, the behavior of your chip through waveforms, but as well the real operations environment. You can have a virtual traffic if you are designing an AI chip for, you know, for self-driving applications. You can represent the traffic where the chip will be operating, virtual networks, the deterministic ICE for making the hardware environment that you are creating around the emulator for reproducing the operational environment of your chip. This is hardware could become deterministic during the debug process to be able to reproduce exactly the same behavior from run to run when you need to debug a problem. And as well, being able to validate, for example, your design for test infrastructure into the chip, which is an essential part for making high quality devices. Think that being deterministic and creating an environment for testing the chip within a particular application, virtualization is essential, because instead of using hardware components around the hardware emulation engine, you create a set of virtual building blocks of the environment where the chip will be operating. And so you remove by default the indeterminism of the hardware that is part of the chip itself. So through pure software components that represent the operating elements of your chip, you will be able to validate, execute exhaustive tests in a very deterministic environment. So if you have your chip mapped into your emulator, instead of having cables that interconnect the PCI Express to the actual PCI Express bus of a PC, you will have transactors that will allow to connect the emulator to a co-modeling host, where you have all the different models of your PCI Express model, and you have all the software debug components. You may have your virtual Ethernet packet generator to test the interconnect the channels if you have a networking chip. And as well, you have all the tools on the host that will allow, for example, to do the power estimation of your chip. So you will be able both to validate the UPF, if you to validate your low power infrastructure of the chip, but as well to do activity plots to verify the peak of activities, and then to estimate what will be the actual power consumption for those peaks. And all these within a completely virtualized environment, without the need of having external components affecting the behavior of these verification steps. And here is an example where, virtualization is not only valuable, but as well is the only way to validate the behavior of, for example, an artificial intelligent chip designed for automotive. You'll be able to validate how the decisions made, if they are correct or not, well before putting the car on the street. In this example, using tools from Siemens, like the Pre-Scan, and taking a set of accident databases that are available from different sources, you can apply a certain scenario to the chip, AI chip that is mapped on the Veloce. In this example, is a car driving on the street and crossing a traffic light. And you have here the left and right sensor camera input. So you are able to model as well the sensors that will be used on this autonomous car. And the data goes into the emulator where you have your AI chip. So you have your sensors fusion process, and as well you have the chip that takes decisions that are sent to the model of the dynamics of the car. In this case, it could be the tires, the braking system, and steering, and so forth. So you have all the powertrain model of your car available, that interacts with the emulator through the standard interfaces. And you see here that doesn't run, but I apologize that there is a problem with animation here through the WebEx, but you apply the stimuli. You apply the stimuli, and here you see actually how the behavior of the car is. And in this case, you would see that you should see that the car is behaving wrongly, is crossing a red light, and is getting too close to a car that is getting out from a parking lot. So this allows to see how the overall system behaves within a completely virtualized environment, and this is obviously the only way to validate such a type of device before going to the actual roads, and well before having any silicon available in the lab to validate it with the different test instruments this type of behavior. So this is for saying that scalability for accommodating capacity expansions of the chips, complexity expansions of the chips with capacity available on the emulator. A determinism, the behavior of the emulator is key for being able to effectively debug, and the virtualization of the whole environment enables the determinism, but as well as in some cases, as we have seen the example of, for the self-driving applications, virtualization becomes a mandatory step for having the full representation of the system is a digital twin of the car, if you will, within the environment that will be operating to be able to validate the chips and algorithm that will be used for self-driving the car. And with that, okay. The presentation is finished. If there are some questions, I would be happy to answer.